Hi, my name's Simon. I'm here to talk about Redis with MicroPython. We're going to do that with some hardware context because MicroPython group, we all like building things, and also database concepts on their own aren't that interesting. So illustrating them with hardware and pressing buttons is fun. Now, normally this would be a longer session and I would be able to hand out devices and we could all actually press the buttons and do the thing. So I'm going to do that remotely with the help of a second camera that hopefully won't let me down. And if it does, the backup plan is we'll hold things up to this camera and see what happens. So first off, what is actually Redis? And full disclosure, I'm a developer advocate for Redis, the company. So I'm here to advocate for Redis, the open source product. It's basically a sort of database that uses a key value model. So it's not a SQL type database with tables. We store things at keys, and what is at those keys are values of different data types. And we'll look at that in a minute. The big party trick for Redis, if you like, is speed. And that's because a copy of the entire data set lives in RAM on the server at all times. So people will then say, oh no, what happens if I pull the plug out? I've lost my database, it's all in RAM. A copy of the data lives in RAM at all times. It's also configurably persistent. So if you don't want persistence and you just want something ephemeral like a cache or whatever, fine. If you do want persistence, you can configure that and then you've got something durable. And now you've got a very fast data store that does some interesting things. It's available on a network, so we connect to it on a host and a port like you would with normal databases. And that's what we're going to do from some little PyPico devices today. We'll connect to Redis in the cloud and do some stuff with it. What's the picture in the background? It's kind of how I try and explain key value storage to people. So the picture in the background is a woman doing filing at the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. in I think the 1970s. And basically, if you imagine the data store as a huge load of boxes, so she's got all of these files here, and each of them have a name, so like the label tag on the front, then if you know the name and you can open the box, then you can get to what's inside. And that's kind of key value data storage in a nutshell. Like you store things in a key and you retrieve it by the key. So you kind of have to know that key. It's a sort of locker concept. So very, very basics. What happens here with Redis is we can connect to it. It's got a CLI. It's got SDKs for pretty much every programming language, including MicroPython. And we interact with it in a command base, so command basis. So here we want to set the value of a key to some value. So we're going to set cat to mocha, which might be the name of a cat, and set dog to latte. And we've got a bit of a coffee theme going on. And then conceptually, what that looks like over on the right is we've got the blue things are keys, so the bit of information we need to know to be able to get that value back. And then we do get cat and we get back mocha, the value that we stored there. So at a very, very basic level, that's how it works. It's a sort of storage and retrieval thing. And what we're storing here is simple strings, and that's actually what most people use Redis for, caching things. So web pages, API results, stuff like that. You then serve that from a web server further up the chain than your application server. You save a lot of origin hits. You get things back faster. Obviously, at the expense of that data might be a little bit old. So the other thing that Redis does out of the box is it can expire things. So things can be told to go away after a couple of minutes. And you would write application logic that would say, hey, check Redis. Is the thing in Redis? No, go get it from wherever it really lives, like some other slower data store. Put it in Redis on the way back and send it out. And then the next time it comes back, it will be in Redis for a period of time and you get that cache result. So key value data storage gets a little bit more complicated than that. So we don't just have strings in the Redis data store. We have all sorts of things. And this set of data types that are available kind of looks like a weird random Swiss Army knife grab bag of things. And in some ways it is, because Redis originally was one person's original project to solve some problems that they had. And they kept building on it and open sourced it and kept solving problems that they had at the company they were working at or places they were working at that needed things. So there's things in there like a list, which can look like a queue. There's a string, there's a hash, which is that sort of object. There's geospatial, so find me all the things that are near some other things. You can now store JSON documents in there without encoding them and then sort of access them, you know, just get little bits of the JSON out, which is great for small like MicroPython devices, because you don't want to retrieve a whole document, parse it on the device. You just want to get the path into, say, an array or an object or some other set of paths that you want to get out of there without pulling the rest of that document. And then there's a whole load of other things that we don't really have time for today. There's what are called probabilistic data structures, which are fun because they're sort of lossy, like JPEG compression. They lie a little bit. And the advantage is that they save space. So if you want to count how many distinct things you've seen over a period of time, like maybe car license plates, and you don't care about getting that actual data back, then the hyperloglog algorithm is quite interesting. That uses hashes to store identifiers in a way that they can't be retrieved because they've been hashed away, and then tell you how many distinct identifiers it's seen. But with hashes come clashes, and with that comes some level of inaccuracy. So you can sort of tweak that level of inaccuracy, and what you're doing is trading off between accuracy and storage space. But that's kind of another talk for another day. The one we're going to look at today, because it's kind of interesting to data acquisition in small devices, is the stream data type, which if you work with Apache Kafka, there's a lot of similar concepts here. I'm not going to say the two things are equivalent because they're not. They both have their own place. But the idea of a Redis stream is that we link producers with consumers with a sort of buffer in between. So the example we're going to look at today is one that I use in conferences, because everyone at a conference has usually been to a hotel or is currently staying in one. And when they're in the hotel, they usually need something done for them. So what we're going to do is look at a stream that handles sort of front desk room service jobs in a hotel. So here we have what's called a producer, which is somebody that's creating jobs or work and putting it into the stream, and a consumer, which is someone who is reading from that stream and doing the work. Now, the interesting thing with this is you might say, well, this is a queue. And it's like, it is a queue in some cases, or in it looks like a queue. But the difference between this and a traditional queue is that consuming it, so reading those entries, doesn't remove them from the stream. And the reason for that is we might have multiple types of consumer that want to do different things with them. So reading from the stream doesn't remove the job. That's kind of a separate action that you would have to take a conscious decision to do. But reading from the stream means that, you know, you've seen it, you've gone and done the job. And then we might have some other sort of consumers going on here. So we might have one that looks for, say, those fetch me a taxi jobs and charges a tip fee to the room or something, or looks for the cleaning jobs and goes away and updates inventory of cleaning products or towels or something like that. So we can have multiple consumers that read from this stream. So what's going on here is we put things in the stream, and when we put them in there, they get a timestamp. So it's also a sort of ordered append-only log. So the oldest thing in this stream is over there on the right. It ends in 195-0. And you might wonder, why do the timestamps end in dashes and then a number? It's because Redis is fast enough to be able to cope with multiple things coming into the stream in the same millisecond. So what it'll do is then put a sequence number on the end of them automatically to make sure that we keep the actual order that they arrive. You can see here we've got three things in the stream. They represent a point in time. And then we've got payloads in there. And what the payload is a set of name value pairs. And I've chosen room and job for this example. One of the things with NoSQL databases and Redis specifically is there's generally no schema for anything. So we've got a stream here called jobs, and we've sort of set a convention that the payload in there is going to be, there's going to be a room key and a job key. And the only reason that that is being enforced is because our application or whatever's putting things into the queue is doing that. We could put something in there that would be something completely different, like staffing information or something. We could put the name of a staff member and when they started, and then the name of a staff member and when they stopped their shift. And Redis is not going to enforce that this stream is actually about jobs. We could put any old stuff in there, and it's on the application to understand what's in there and deal with it. So that's sort of flexibility, but with flexibility comes a bit of responsibility. So let's see what we've got next. I've also got a sleepy keyboard. There we go. So what we want to do with the stream is, first off, we need to add some entries to it. The Redis command for that is something called xadd, and we tell it what the name of the stream is. So a key for the stream we're adding to. So we're adding something called jobs. Then we have an asterisk, which is like, hey, Redis, give us a timestamp for that. You can provide your own if you've got your own sequences. But again, especially with small devices like Pi Picos and stuff, you may or may not have a real-time clock. And you may not want to keep all of those things in sync. So you can just basically say, use the server time, don't worry about it. And then we send it a set of names and values that we want to store against that stream at that specific time. And it'll go away and put it in the stream for us. One of the cool things about Redis as well is there's generally no create step for most things. So what happens if the job stream doesn't exist? Well, xadd will just create it for us. We don't have to put logic in a tiny device or on a server somewhere that says, if stream doesn't exist, then go ahead and create the stream, then put the first thing in it. We don't have to have like a database schema stored with our application that says, run this thing first and set the database up. It's generally going to build itself as it needs to, as it goes along. So that's how we put things in the stream. And as we keep putting them in there, they'll sort of line up in a nice order. And they're immutable, so we can delete them, but we can't change them. So that entry ending in 197, that's always going to be a taxi for room 199. So that's kind of important for audit scenarios. We can't change what happened. We can delete it. We can logically delete it as well so that consumers don't see it, but an audit trail would. But we cannot change it. So once we got stuff in there, how do we get stuff out again when we want to do something with it? There's a couple of ways of doing that. We're not really going to use this one in this example, but we can ask it for a range of IDs, which, because IDs are timestamps, is a range of time. So we can say, you know, what happened between these two times? And it will come back and tell us what happened between those two times and give us the results that we see on the screen. So if we ask it, you know, what happened between the timestamp ending 197 and 199, we'll get those two items. We don't need to worry about that sequence number on the end. Database will handle that for us. And we'll be told that at that point, 412 wanted room service, 199 wanted a taxi. And we don't always want to read it like that, though. So that's great for like what happened at a given time. But sometimes what we want to do, perhaps the most common thing we want to do, is have somebody do the jobs that are in the stream. And in that case, it makes kind of the most sense for them to do them in the order they arrive. So oldest one first. And there's, in that case, there's a different command called xread, where we give it the ID of something that we've seen already. And we say, give me the next however many in the stream, regardless of what their IDs are or when they happened or what the time gap is. So I can start at the start by saying xread count two. I want two things back from a stream called jobs. And the lowest ID I've seen so far is zero, which is like the start point, 1970. And it will come back with those first two items, oldest two in the stream. And I can then, after that, use the ID that I received last, so that one that ends in 1951, and say, okay, now give me two that are newer than that, and we can walk through the stream like that. So that way we can wander through the stream and read all the jobs and maybe do something about them. But remember again that reading these doesn't take them off. It's not a queue. They're still going to exist. So then to get a little bit more complex, and that's kind of where the theory ends, well, what happens if I'm doing the jobs? So me, Simon, is the person that does all of the room service jobs, whatever type of job they are, and I'm the only consumer. That's great because I can read through and remember where I was, and I can ask it for the job after the one that I've just done, and it'll give me the next one and all of that. But in the real world, multiple people are going to do my job. My job is going to be a role. It's not going to be Simon does all of the room service jobs. So we would have lots of people on staff doing my job, and they need to collaboratively work together to process this stream. So Redis has a concept of consumer groups for this. And what consumer groups allow us to do is create like a logical role. So we'll call it staff. And say, I, Simon, I'm a member of staff. Give me the next job that no member of staff has seen so far. So what we do with that is we basically just say there's an xread group command. I create a group, a consumer group called staff with xgroup create up there. And what it does is it creates a group in that stream, and we tell it where we want to start. So we'll say we're starting at zero at the beginning. And then basically with xread group, I can use is greater than as a special ID and say, give me the next job that nobody else in my group has yet seen. So we can ensure that we're not all chasing around the hotel doing the same jobs. And there's one extra step with this, which is I need to acknowledge that I've done that job, because there's also a mechanism that's way beyond the scope of this talk for like, well, what if I go to do that job and I never actually complete it? Or what if there's some data in that job that causes my process to fall over and die? Then that job is in a sort of orphan state and needs to be recovered and allocated to someone else. So if I don't acknowledge the job after a certain time, we can basically ask the stream how many jobs have been assigned to people that they haven't been completed in the last, say, 10 minutes. And then we can start to take actions to mitigate that, like give it to someone else or go look at the data. So that's consumer groups. That's generally all the theory. And it's a bit of a crash course because we're sort of going a little bit faster than we normally would. But to put this into a sort of context of this group, we're going to look at this with some hardware. And the hardware that I use for this workshop is all from Raspberry Pi and Pimaroni. There's a box over there on the right. It just happens to fit all of the equipment really nicely when you're transporting loads of these. And what we use is what they call a GFX pack, which is a small LCD display. And you plug a Pi Pico W into the back, or a regular Pi Pico if you don't want the internet. And you can then install MicroPython on it and start working with it. And the things I like about this are it's got down the bottom there on the left, it's got what Adafruit called a Stemma QT adapter. So we can plug in other sensors and things. So you could potentially add a hardware input. It's got 5 buttons on the front, so people can mash buttons and do things. It's got an LED in the back of the screen, so we can change the color of the screen, even though it's monochrome, and we can draw freely on the screen. And we'll look at how that works. So what I'm going to do is attempt to demonstrate some stuff on the desk. So let's swap over to, hopefully we can all see a second camera embedded there. So what I'm going to do is the reason why I'm using this is because then I can mix and match it with looking at data in the database, and it saves swapping cameras and life with Zoom is a lot easier. So this is one of these devices. It's currently turned off. It's got the 5 buttons across the bottom of the screen. It's got a really nice put your Pico in this way, so you can't mess it up. And it's got the adapter for other sensors. And you will basically just put your Pico in there. You obviously need to solder the headers on first. I've been doing this with large groups, so I get these pre-headed because I'm lazy and it saves a lot of soldering. And then you can plug other things in. So we've got like a little Pimaroni RGB encoder here, it's a rotary encoder. It has a LED in it. It could connect directly to this device. So we've got a few of those up and running. Generally, I do this workshop with about a dozen, so you get lots of people doing different jobs. But if we pull these into view, and the light and the focus is a little bit all over the place, we can find it. I've got three of them up and running. And what's really nice about these devices is Pimeroni provide a graphics library for them that if you can learn the MicroPython library for this device, which is pretty simple, it's got a sort of rectangle, line, bitmap fonts, all of that sort of stuff, then you can work with their other displays. So they have other things that have different display tech. So this one is e-ink, for example. It's also got a Pico W on the back, but that's actually soldered in. It doesn't come out. And if you've seen their Tufty TFT device, it's all the same library. So any time you spend with one of these devices is well spent, because you can then, you know, easily port your code to something else. So if you wanted to move to a slower moving e-ink device, then you can do that. So putting this into hardware, we need a couple of things. So we need somewhere programming the device, so MicroPython, and we need a Redis client or library that will enable us to talk to Redis. These are fairly easy to write because Redis uses a string-based protocol. You connect to a socket and send it encoded strings, and you get encoded strings back after it's done something and return the results. And people have done this. So we have got from the community, let's go back to here a minute. We have got a Redis client that is called Pico Redis. So I guess Pi Pico it's designed for, but it works on all sorts of things that run MicroPython. I think it runs with regular Python as well, because it's just basically handling strings and bytes and a socket. It's not doing anything incredibly clever. But what this does is it enables us to get to a start point of working with Redis from the device very, very quickly. And we still have to deal with some things that if you've worked with Redis in other platforms, you wouldn't have to. So this doesn't necessarily decode everything that comes back from the server. It's all going to be bytes, and you sort of decode strings as you need them. And it doesn't unpack things into the best Python data structure representation. So if you pull something back that looks like an object, it's not going to make a dictionary of it for you. You're going to get lists of lists, which is kind of how Redis natively returns things. So this works at quite a low level, but that's okay for these sorts of things. And it enables us to talk directly to the data store from the little device. So what I'll do really quickly is come back to here. And these are all, focus on the lights a little bit off. These are all connected to my Wi-Fi, and the demo application we've got that I'll share the code for, it presents a menu, and there's like three Redis actions we can do. We can become the producer, so the person that puts things into the stream. We can become a consumer, one of the group that takes things and does the jobs. We can look at the status of the stream, so we can be an observer. And then I've got another thing that just calls an API, so that when I run this as a workshop, people also take away a bit of code that just calls an API and shows results on the screen here and doesn't have anything to do with Redis. So if we start that, it's actually going to call something called the carbon intensity API that over here in the UK will tell me where my electricity is currently coming from. And what you'll see is my backlight's gone red, because now's kind of a bad time to be using electricity here, because it looks like the majority of my generation is gas, and then solar and wind are kind of well down there, and we've got almost no nuclear. So there's example code in the code base for just calling an API, and it just uses U requests and parses that out, and also shows how to draw bars with Pimeroni's library. We'll come back to that. The other thing that's great about this device when you're using them in scale and to teach people is the reset button. So I can reset it without unplugging the USB and dealing with all the notifications that you get. And you'll see that it's now connecting and it's gone green and flashed and it's on my Wi-Fi, and we're back where we were. So let's quickly do a little bit of a side-by-side demo. So I have a view here into the Redis instance that we're looking at. This is a tool that is a freebie, and it allows you to see what's going on in the data store. So at the minute, we have a completely empty stream of jobs, and we have nothing else in there. There's no other keys. And what we can see is there's absolutely nothing going on here. So if we start to move things around the screen a little bit. So if I start to use these devices, what we should see is, let's pick this one here. And I need to set the desktop the other way because I'm actually left-handed. And we turn it into a producer. What you'll see is it's now sat there. So imagine we're at the front desk and somebody comes along and we're like, oh, you want a job doing? We'll press create job. And it's generated a random job of cleaning in room 367. And you'll see that's appeared over there on the right in the database as well. And it's got a timestamp. And we can create another one, extra towels for room 171. And basically, we are now capturing data. So imagine if you had a stream of, you know, temperature or other data, light data, whatever, from a different, you know, set of sensors. You could put any of that sort of stuff in here. We've just chosen to build something more interactive so that in a workshop, people can literally press buttons. And once we've got the stuff in there, what we then want to do is maybe have somebody take a look at what's going on. So if I press C for stream status here, you'll see that I've got nobody's working at the moment. No one's doing jobs. And we've got a lag of two. So we are two jobs behind customer requests at the minute. And you'll see my screen is green because we've decided that, yeah, that's an okay situation to be in. So if I then go back to the producer here and create another job, you'll see a third one's gone on and the status is updated. And now we're orange because we're in now sort of a mildly concerning state of, we're three jobs behind. That's terrible customer service. We need to do something about this. So what we need to do is start a consumer. And what the consumer will do is it's got a button for I'm ready to work the next job. And it's going to be given the oldest job, which was that cleaning job down the bottom of my table there in room 367. It's done the job. And again, that job hasn't disappeared from the stream. So the reason why that job hasn't disappeared from the stream is because other types of consumer might be interested in it. We might have to record staff time with a different type of consumer, or we might have to record chargeable items if it was deliver champagne to the room. When I say to it, get the next job, it's doing extra towels. So it's doing that second one and it's finished doing that now. So it's told Redis, hey, I'm done with that. And you'll see my status item here has gone down to a lag of one and we're back to green. And if we then go and do the, well, let's get the next job, it's doing extra towels. And we'll be down to zero. We've basically caught up. So it's done. And then if I say to it, okay, consumer, get your next job. And there aren't any. It's time to go take a tea break until the producers make some more. So in a big workshop with lots of people, we'd have lots of people take on these different roles and we would look at how the jobs are allocated. But the thing to know here is you've got a system that on some very small devices that don't have too much intelligence going on, it's orchestrating, managing, there could be 10 of these consumers, 20 of them, and it will make sure that between them, they all get it done. And with a bit of extra logic that if one of them continuously fails, we can detect that and do something about it. So that's the sort of device demo. The obvious thing to look at from here, because it's a MicroPython group, is how we do this. So I've got the Pico Redis client. I just imported it into my project because I wanted a consistent version of it. And it's easier to set up lots and lots of devices by just putting all your dependencies directly in the project. Probably not the best practice, but that's where we are. And the way this works is you connect to a Redis instance and then it exposes a Redis client object that if you call a function on it, it assumes that function is the Redis command name and encodes that with the parameters you pass it, sends it to Redis, and does a sort of mild job of decoding the responses. So the best way of looking at that is in context of how this works. So each of my functions I've put in a separate module. So here's our producer that puts something into the stream. It's a really nice high level API for working with these Pymer only devices. And they've got something called Pico graphics that underlies it. So as I say, if you can learn this, which is not hard, then you can adapt it to all of their things. And that includes LED displays, so the unicorn series. It includes the E-ink one that I've got, the TFTs and the LCDs. So basically what happens is I just have a list of possible job types. And what we do is when we start up, we Pico Redis is pretty simple. It's got a connect method. I've actually hidden that away because I've got some secrets in there for the host, the port, and the password. But that'll deal with connecting over the network for us. And then when we want to actually do something with Redis, we just basically go look up on the command pages what command we want to run. So I want to run xadd, put something in a stream. And first parameters for that is the stream key. So jobs in my case, I just put it in a configurable secrets file. And then we say asterisk is you Redis figure out the ID for that. I don't want to worry about that. And then just the names and the values that we want to put in. And I'm just creating random names and values at this point. And that's basically how it works is if you can figure out the Redis command for something, and they're all pretty well documented at Redis.io, this client will allow you to call stuff, interact directly with the data store, and get the results. And if we look at the consumer side of things, so pulling things out, it's a little bit more complicated because we get a sort of more complicated response. But basically, I run this xread group command that says, hey, I'm a member of the group, whatever I configured it to be. So it's actually called staff. And then I have to provide a unique consumer ID, so like a unique member of the group ID. So I just use part of the IP address of the device for that. So they kind of self-elect and no one has to input stuff. And I say to it, I want one thing from the job stream. And the ID of the last thing I saw is this special ID for, I actually don't know, just give me the next job that no one else doing my role has seen so far. And then if you've worked with Redis in regular Python or other clients, you normally expect a sort of more parsed out response than this. But this client here, because it's doing minimal work on the little devices, it's just going to return a list of basically byte arrays. And then we can decode those into strings and do something with them on the screen. So the rest of this code kind of just deals with that. You know, we go into the lists of lists and pull out the things that we want and show them on the screen. And then in this case of reading as part of a bigger group of consumers, we then have to tell Redis we're actually done with it. So we tell it, hey, we've actually finished this job. And that then puts it in a state on the server that server knows it is finished and knows not to offer it up to other clients if we built logic that that implemented that. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. And then my connection management in here is really simple. We just create a new Pico Redis instance. If you use Redis Pi on regular Python, it's pretty simple, pretty similar. We pass in a host and a port, and then I can authenticate with a password. I could also pass in a username if I was using like a role-based user. I'm just using the sort of default user that can do everything. And at that point, we're connected and we can just start doing things. So yeah, that was about it. Like I say, this is a short version of a longer thing. So I think the things to understand is if you want to play with Redis on small devices, it lends itself to this really, really well because you don't have to write a lot of create step code. You don't have to worry about a lot of branching logic for if this thing exists or it doesn't exist, or I want to do this other thing. it's just very good at put things in a stream, get things out of the stream, put things in a list, pop them off of a list, put them in a mathematical set. How many different things have I seen? And if you were building something like somebody was mentioning a person detector before, if you were building like a person counter, you know, it's potentially good for that. All of this is also binary safe. So I have other projects where the contents of the stream here are actually JPEG images, and then we pull them off and do something with them. So we go look at what's in them and, you know, maybe do some sort of object analysis on them and then take action on that. So what I was going to leave you with was, keyboard's gone to sleep again, was a couple of URLs. So there's a wider workshop here that you don't actually need the hardware to try this, because I wrote all of the MicroPython bits in desktop Python 2 that just run in a terminal. But if you have got the hardware, then it should just work straight out of the box. And also we provide a free course to go learn more about Redis streams specifically. So yeah, that was what I had. So hopefully that was entertaining.
Yeah, that was great. Thanks, Simon. Yeah, really interesting. Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Yeah, PyCon Fair demos, even just like we've passed devices around during PyCon talks before, and yeah, just having different people producing and consuming on a general network. Yeah, super cool, very interactive.
Yeah, it's, I mean, the unit cost of one of these whole things, so like this plus the Pico W plus the, I haven't got one around, but the little storage box is like £3. So it's like £30 over here. So what we do is I have a stock of these that we use with groups. But also it's not horrendous. And what I really, really, really like about this product is also, as Matt was saying, they've really thought about the library for this. So if you start using their stuff, it will work with, like, you know, it's an easy lift to this one, but obviously the display is a lot slower and there's different use cases. And that applies for like the buttons as well as the graphics. And yeah, they've just thought about all of that stuff. And then having this out to put a sensor on it is great, because you could also, yeah, for a little bit more of a budget, you could put any sort of sensor or an encoder, or I've got a trackball that works with them. Then you can build games and all sorts of things. So
yeah, that's cool. So one question I have just about the streams, I think my mind's still just wrapping around the fact that it's a stream, but it's actually like this, you know, built up list of things. Are they, would you, if like, if you were to continue using it how it is now, how the objects just sit in this stream and it continually builds up, is there like performance issues with that? Should we be periodically clearing them, or do you just stack it up?
Yeah, so there's, because a copy of all the data has to live in RAM for Redis, you are basically, you've got as much data space as you've got RAM. And then the way you solve for that is sharding, right? So you put the database on multiple machines. But the stream lives in a single key, so you can't shard at a key, you shard at key space level. So you can't say, oh, jobs, you know, the first half lives on this server and the second half lives on that. So a couple of things, it uses quite a clever radix tree algorithm. So if you keep putting lots of things in there that look pretty much like the last one, it's going to store the difference between them in a binary format to compress things. And also there's a few ways you can trim it. So when you add things into the stream, you can say, I'm adding a new one and keep only the last like 100,000, whatever number you want, and it will chop it at the point of adding it. And that's a little bit arbitrary. So you can also say, and get rid of everything that has an ID lower than this ID that I'm going to give you, which, because the IDs can be timestamps, is like, oh, okay, let's keep this capped at like an hour or 24 hours or something. So you can do that. And there's also a command to just do that out of band. So, you know, if you're not putting things in the stream constantly, then that wouldn't get run. So there's a trim command that you could just run like every cron job time or whatever and be like, oh, is it this big, get rid. Or you can maintain a data structure of like everybody's seen up to this point in the stream. So now we can chop it because the person doing the work's seen it, audit trail's seen it, finance has seen it. Yeah, we can now park that. Yeah, you do need to manage things, but if you wanted something that's like a really fast ingest buffer, or the other thing that I sort of tell people use it for is even if you're not going to use it permanently, use it for prototyping because you can build something with people in a short amount of time where you're just not bothering with all of this schema stuff and setup stuff. And just like, you're getting to the doing bit is quite quick. I want to put something in a data structure. What's the first step? Well, it's putting something in a data structure. It's not messing around with a create command or something.
Yep. No, that's cool. Great. Matt is there. He had a question, but I can read it out because it was in the chat. Does Pico Redis need updating or improving?
What happens with most Redis clients is the Redis community or us, the company, add new commands to Redis to do new things or new modifiers to existing commands. And clients then have to go away and implement those. At the level this is working at, it's basically just an object that says any function you call on this that isn't connect, disconnect, or whatever, throw it at the Redis server and assume it's a command. And if it blows up, then it blows up. So what he's doing is clever in that he's supporting everything by supporting nothing. So I would say it might be useful to have an option. I have reached out to the person that wrote this because I'd love to do some work with them on it. It might be useful to have an option for like, you know, decode things all the time because I just know I'm going to want to do it. Or decode only certain data structures because I know every time I pull a hash, which looks like a small object, I'm always going to convert it to a dict. So just have the library do it for me. But I can also understand why he's not doing that. So you can manage your memory and your time complexity as well.
Yeah.
Accordingly, and because it runs on all sorts of different devices.
Might be some space for a nano Redis, which has got a few more safeties on.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing is people will be like, why are you connecting directly to the database from this? Build some middleware. And it's like, yeah, you could do that, but it's not very interesting. So yeah, traditionally, people did that if you were accessing large JSON docs in Redis, because you'd have to pull the whole thing out as a string, parse it, and then get the value you want. But the database itself will now do that for you. So that kind of use case has naturally gone away as we've improved the product.
That's superb for our product, for MicroPython. Like, we've connected to a bunch of like online resources where you just get this big blob of JSON back, and it's challenging when you've got kilobytes of RAM, JSONs, and megabytes.
I actually worked on a temperature control system for like a commercial company in a previous job that used Firebase, and you couldn't pull, you know, the whole Firebase. So having the ability to just update and pull little bits on the server and let it deal with it was very handy, and it does do that now. Yeah.
Very cool. Love the demo. Like, it's, you're right, it's a good device to experiment with. Like, it's right size, the right number of buttons and stuff. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, it's also very hard for people. Someone's going to break one day, but it's very hard for people to break. Because people are like, I give them pre-headed picos and usually push the two together so that you don't, you know, ham-fist it and break all the headers off. But once it's in there, you don't need anything. Like, the reset button is just really handy.
Yeah.
I think the other shout out that I could give for experience, if you ever run workshops with these things, is, color is your friend. So if you're the instructor and you're stood in front of a room of people and you can see that they've all got a green thing because you've told them to plug it in and it will connect to the Wi-Fi, you save a lot of time with like, are we all good here?
Yeah, that's perfect.
So color's your friend. And also, somebody out there on the internet that I don't have a link for, it's the guy in Germany that runs the PyJams, I think, wrote a script to just bypass all the dialogues on a Mac, detect a Pico, and flash a UF2 to it. And when you've got like 48 of them to do,
Sandy,
go look up the script because it works great. And you don't have to dismiss all the dialogues and like, have I seen this before? And so on. It's just like, we're done, start again, we're done, start again. I've had like 100% success rate with flashing things with that. Just makes workshops a lot less frustrating and what they should be about, which is let's build something.
Very nice. Reggie, we were talking about using Chrome's USB support to try to deploy to devices, which might be another way to do that too. Yeah,
I have actually thought about doing a demo where we put the UF2s in Redis because everything's binary, and then build some sort of like, you know, select a download configurator thing, but that's a little bit away, I think.
Yeah, I mean, ideally, we're looking at this from the MicroPython download page point of view. So when you go to the download you want to grab, you could just hit the button that says deploy and then choose to connect to a device and it'll just go off and do it. We're a long way from getting that working, but it's conceptually possible.
Yeah, but thanks for having me. It's the other thing that's been fun is, you know, during the hardware shortage, the PicoWs have been easier to get. So
yeah,
we sort of moved a lot of content creation towards that just because you can do it.
Yeah, it's good. And at least you can get the Raspberry Pis now as well. There's a lot of people screaming out for those for a while. So
yeah, I was able to pick one up in person this week for the first time in ages. But I noticed now Pimeroni and I think Pi Hut and some others are like, oh, you can buy 10 now.
Yes. That's cool. That's great. Well, thank you, Simon. I'm glad we've been talking for a while to try to tie it up. That was great. Really cool. Great show. And do you recommend the Redis Cloud to try this out, or is that and just have the devices connect directly?
This is where I normally am like, put the other hat on. So everything we saw today is open source Redis. You can go get it from wherever you get Redis. I won't tell you where it comes from because there's lots of places. So if you wanted to run it on Docker or whatever, or in the various clouds, you can do. If you go to redis.com, there's a try free. And that's what we were using today. It's like a 30 meg instance that lasts forever. It's great for this sort of workshoppy content because either everyone can have one, or you can all share a common one. And again, then the instructor knows from what state of the database is that everyone's been able to connect to it. I can see that. So we use that. And like, where is Redis Cloud? Well, it's kind of anywhere you want to put it. So you can choose when you create it. Oh, I want it on AWS in Ohio, or I want it on Azure in Singapore, or whatever. So the idea is you put it near where you want to run your code, but when your code's running on a device, just put it somewhere that's in the world closest. I mean, so for latency, all of those examples, my database is actually in Ohio and I'm in Nottingham in England. So
yeah,
it's not bad.
Cool. Very cool. And the code's available. I didn't catch the URL, but...
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, cool. Okay.
Do that. Yeah, the code for this is available. And again, because I don't expect everybody to have or get the hardware, and also so that we can put load on it faster, there's desktop Python versions that just use a terminal library to do nice progress bars and stuff, but do exactly the same thing. So you can mix and match a fleet of both of them.
Cool. And I'll add a package JSON to Pico Redis, so it's a bit easier to install as well. That might help. Well, it looks like it's just one file, so it's
It is just the one file, but I'm also like not the greatest MicroPython person, so I thought, oh, maybe I should distribute this compiled in the project, or I don't know, or whatever. But I also wanted to leave the source code there because quite often I'm talking about how it works and it's all in the one place.
So. Yeah, cool. Good. Well, look, thank you very much, Sam. That was great. Thanks.
No problem. I'll stick around and mute.
Cool.